Shall I begin?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, yeah. Hello and good evening, everybody. Welcome to yet another session of Talking Films Online. We've had a series of events to celebrate our first anniversary. And today in July, for the first session, we get back to our program of film discussion. We have with us Dr. Anil Sonmani. He will be leading the discussion on Achhoot Kanya. Anil teaches English and related courses at St. Gonzalo Garcia College of Arts and Commerce, Vasai. He worked in the area of early Indian cinema for his PhD degree. His areas of interest are film studies, literary theory, and Western philosophy. And as he puts it, he tries to read and write in English and Marathi. Welcome, Anil. We look forward to the session. Please carry on.
Thank you. Thank you, Geeta. I would straight away begin with sharing a slide, a PPT, a few comments on the film or analysis paragraphs of the film by some of the film theorists that we have. That is just to begin with. Okay, is it visible?
Yes, yes.
Assuming that most of you have watched the film, this is Joyojit Pal, Niranjan Pal's grandson, who writes. His most famous work with Bombay Talkies, Niranjan Pal's, because Niranjan Pal did write the script of the film and was a part of the production house. His most famous work with Bombay Talkies, though, was the controversial blockbuster Achhoot Kanya, 1936, still a household name in India. The film deals with an ill-fated romance between a boy from a Brahmin family and a girl from an untouchable family. In the film, both conformity and non-conformity are equally impossible options, underlining important social questions that the soon-to-be free nation would face. The exploration of mob mentalities towards preventing cross-caste relationships are eerily relevant three quarters of a century later. An Indian film, as Indian filmmakers of the day grapple with ways of examining honor killings on screen. Some of the articles, research papers that I've come across on caste issues in cinema, they do refer to Achhoot Kanya. So what Joyojit Pal is saying kind of reverberates, witness it in the kind of films that are being made that deal with caste issues today, and also the kind of writing, academic writing that's coming out related to caste issues in cinema. Obviously, this is not the only issue for which this film has to be watched. The next quotation comes from Ashish Raja Dakshan, Paul Willman, the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema. A circular story told in flashback, in which eternal repetition is only interrupted by death in the form of a relentlessly linear railway engine. The film opens at a railway crossing where a man is about to kill his wife, when the narrative spins into the past via a song. The central story is of the unhappy love affair between Kasturi, played by Devi Karani, the Harijan, daughter of the railway crossing guard, Dukhia, and Pratap, played by Ashok Kumar, the Brahmin son of the grocer. At first, the rumor and mob violence are deployed to ladle effect in order to maintain a traditional oppressive morality. Later, when the main protagonists are about to conform and marry selected partners, rumor and maliciousness again intervene to trigger renewed violence until the on-rushing train of fate stops the strife. Now, these are some of the important comments that we come across in the academics, because there were absolutely no material available in early 2010s on some of these films that were produced in 1930s, and Achyut Kanya being one of them. These were only write-ups, articles that were available to read on some of these films. Thus, these comments, these observations become very, very important and also make sense, because as we see in the film, it begins with railway crossing and a couple who is there in the car and is about to cross the railway line, but as the railway guard says that between 12 to 1 a.m. at night, a ghost appears there, and thus he would not allow them to pass. Well, the ghost actually appears, and it's an old man's ghost, and which says that the monument that's present there of Kasturi, and there is a tragic story, the story of sacrifice of that lady. And failing and listening of that story of the sacrifice, it's something that brings peace to the mind of the listener. And as the guard keeps telling the couple that the ghost appears every day, every night there, thus it's kind of a ritual that happens of narrating the story of the sacrifice. And the entire film after that happens in flashback. Obviously, by the end of the film, the moment Kasturi's story ends, Achyut Kanya's story ends, we come back to the couple and the ghost or the old man. And the couple says that it has a problem. So it's consuming of the story or a narrative of an Achyut Kanya. So I would like to play that clip now, and then we will do kind of an analysis of some of those shots. I'll just stop sharing the PPT here now.
The audio is not playing.
Is the sound playing?
Not when you played it just now. No, the sound was not playing.
I cannot hear the sound. I don't know about the others. I cannot hear the sound. But I think we have all watched.
Yeah, so it's okay since we have watched the film. Or I think you have to enable audio
sound.
On screen share.
Yes. How do I do that? From where do I enable the sound?
There's a little box you have to tick which says play, enable audio or something of that kind.
This is before you actually
before
start.
You, actually,
yeah.
Before you start the video, you have to do that.
Before it's, I share.
Yeah. Before you share. It's on the left side. It's on the left side.
Yes.
एक ना ही खुल सके 12:50 की गाड़ी आ रही है तो अभी तो 12 भी नहीं बजे तो यहां मैं मेरो का कसूर है साहब 1 बजे से पहले मैं हिरकिश फाटक ना खोलूंगा 12 और 1 बजे के बीच यहां भूत आओ करे भूत अच्छा राम हरे राम हरे राम
तुम्हें छोड़ लिया
ताकि तुम खुद देखो सुनो और अनुभव करो वो उस पर जान देती थी
ओके थर्केश्वर सर सेज दैट वी हैव वॉच्ड द फिल्म एंड आई कैन स्टार्ट एक्सप्लेनिंग सो द फिल्म बिगिंस विद द बैकग्राउंड म्यूजिक एंड अ स्मॉल टेंपल इन क्लोज अप showing a carved statue of the face of a woman. The camera slowly tilts down to show the writing at the base of the temple. The writing is read as she sacrificed her life to save others' lives. The image fades in onto the close-up of the written words, emphasizing them. This close-up is followed by a mid-long shot framing the entire temple. One more fade in is used for the visual transition and a half lit house, supposedly railway station, is shown with a pan from the left of the frame to the right. With one more fade in frame, now we have railway signal on the left and railway guard closing the railway gate. From the opposite side of the frame, a car approaches. And the use of light and shadow, particularly in this sequence, creates the atmosphere of mystery. The man gets down from the car, the guard leaves the frame. While getting down from the car, he drops his gun. His wife gives the gun back to him. The significance of the gun is revealed only later at the end of the film. However, it is easy to guess that he had the gun with him to kill his wife. The man starts walking towards the temple and a song is heard in the background. Now, this is where the technological elements have to be taken into account. The source of the song cannot be traced. One, his wife observes the atmosphere around her gaze, followed by the camera recording the trees and the full moon in the low angle pan. That stops at the end of the temple, followed by a cut and her gaze going in the same direction. The next shot is a mid close-up, keeping the same camera angle. The man asks his wife to go back to the car. This is where, after a cut, a tree is seen in the mid shot and an old man appears on the right side of the screen with superimposition. This old man, as we get to know, is the source of the song. It's only later that the source of the song is revealed. Otherwise, we would generally call it in the language of literary theory or literature, a third person kind of narration. The diegesis that comes out of has actually is not present in the scene. But the moment the old man appears, the ghost appears, we get to know the source of the song. And it's heard from the beginning of the sequence. The song stops and the lady reads about the lines written at the bottom of the temple. The red image is heard now. Earlier, we would just get to read that she sacrificed her life. Now the lady repeats what is written on the monument. The old man repeats the same lines. It's emphasized again and again in the film. There is a special emphasis given on the act of sacrifice that the woman in the monument has gone through. The old man suggests the couple that the telling and listening of the story of this woman brings salvation. The lady from the car requests the old man to narrate the story of the sacrifice. The old man metaphorically says, "I'll remove the veil from the gone moments." This old man is shown with low angle shot and his hand movement matches the vibe as a visual transition suggesting the unveiling of the virtual past. The next shot with a vibe as a visual transition goes back to the past, to the story of Kasturi and Pratap. And this opening sequence suggests some interesting formations of movement image, breaking the sensory motor schema, but actually not transforming into time image. These are the two images, basic images that Gilles Deleuze would talk about in his cinema books. Movement image would basically depend on the sensory motor schema in the sense that one image is logically followed by the other without any gaps into it, without breaking of that dependence of one action calling for a reaction. And then again, that reaction would be followed by some sort of shot. And this, as we know, can be done using various kinds of editing techniques. Montage, for example. Now, the song heard in this scene initially does not have the source of its enunciation. The visuals that go with this song are of nature, the tree, the full moon in the sky. The lady in the vehicle looks at the sky, the moon, and the treetops. It becomes difficult to confirm whether her action of looking is a reaction to the perception of the sound image. The song is about God being omnipresent and non-discriminating. The visuals of the sky, the moon, and treetops go with the lyrics of God being present everywhere in the world. The appearance of the ghost brings in the source of the song in the visual image. The ghost's act of revealing the past, going back to the memory, it is a recollection image. But this recollection comes from habitual recognition, as we have seen that the ghost keeps telling this story to people who have to stop there between to one at the railway crossing. The ghost tells the couple that the telling and listening of the story of the woman's sacrifice brings in salvation, and the railway guard's explanation that the ghost appears every day or every night points towards the repetition of the act of recollection of the story of sacrifice. The recollection thus is associated with the sensory motor schema. For the time image to appear, the visual images and the sound images have to form new circuits and do on their own and do away with the sensory motor schema, the dependence on each other, which actually is not happening here. Thus, the way we would traditionally call it a flashback, it goes into the same category. And this is what precisely happens. Kasturi, who sacrifices her life for others, is told in flashback. And at the end, of the film after the flashback is over, the ghost disappears with a fade out from the frame. The tension between the husband and the wife subsides, and the film ends with Kasturi's monument in the frame. Now, this, to begin with, is the structure of the film, the story within the story, kind of a structure that we come across. But as we move ahead in the film, the story of Kasturi, there are some important moments in the film that I would like to focus on. One, immediately after this scene, it is shown how the kid's friendship develops, but at the same time, their parents' friendship, the Brahmin grocer and the Achhut railway guard. So the Brahmin grocer is stung by snake, and it's the Achhut guard who has to touch him and suck out the venom out of his body. So that touch is something that is considered to be permissible, though Dukhiya would apologize for touching him. As we move ahead in the film, when Mohanlal, the grocer, wants to help out Dukhiya, kind of repayment of what he had done to him, saving his life, when Dukhiya is not well, he asks Dukhiya to come to his home so that he can help him out there. And he does that, but the entire village does not approve of Mohanlal's action of letting Dukhiya in his house, which creates a problem. So that kind of touch is not allowed in that structure of the village. And moreover, the film is divided into at least four sections for me. The first section is the world of two lovers, where their innocence towards the caste discrimination gets contaminated gradually as the narrative moves forward. Initially in the film, Kasturi and Pratap seem to be completely unaware of the caste barriers that might stop them from forming the union of love. But the gradual realization of the caste hierarchy makes them take decisions they regret later. The second section is that of Mohanlal and Dukhiya's friendship. The friendship materializes into a strong relationship, a strong bond, despite both of them being aware of the caste discrimination in the society. Mohanlal, though, does not believe in the practice of untouchability when it comes to Dukhiya. He keeps him in his house to take care of him, but he is helpless in the case of Pratap and Kasturi's union. The third section comprises of Babulai Vaidya and Pratap's mother, representing the strong social caste hierarchy. Also, Babulal Vaidya represents everything that goes against modernity at that point of time, because he practices his traditional medicine, which does not help the villagers at all, whereas Mohanlal's quinine that he sells helps people in malaria in the village. Babulal Vaidya and Pratap's mother representing the strong social caste hierarchy, and Babulal Vaidya along with other villagers enforce the practice of untouchability. The fourth section would be agencies of modernity, the modern medicine and governmentality in the form of police and railway and medicine are situated at the brink of the village. These sections are intercut at various stages in the film. The sound, however, plays a very important role in terms of forming connections between these sections. The speech forms the subactions, partially closed sets open onto other sets or other shots, with the connections of speech, the visual images do not have to depend on the gaze for the expansion of sets the outer field the way it would be the case in 1920s when silent films were made. They were mostly dependent on the gaze of the characters or some sort of visual pointer to move on to the new shot. With talkies, with the sound coming, sound played that role. In the film, the issue of caste is not fully absorbed by Pratap and Kasturi or not realized the seriousness of the caste issues initially, at least. Their restriction, their reactions are to the situation, though created by the problem of discrimination based on caste and not directly to the problem. This, there appears to be acceptance of the given situation on the part of both the young lovers. On the contrary, Mohanlal responds to the situation with an action by continuing his friendship with Dukhiya and bringing him in his house. The story of Kasturi ends in tragedy. The situation in the village does not change much. The village remains more or less unchanged, unresponsive to the agencies of modernity. The organization of a whole in this film follows the organic montage of an American school. As it has been stated already, the film is divided into four sections. Sections that want to conform to the tradition and the caste hierarchy, and the sections that want to practice elements of modernity and do away with the caste barriers, which is impossible in the film. These parts, as Deleuze would analyze Griffith's method of montage, are taken in binary relationships which constitute a parallel alternate montage, the image of one part succeeding another according to a rhythm. These parts enter into relationship with each other. They threaten to outdo each other. At one level, Babulal is being punished by the police. On the other, Kasturi meets the tragic fate as a result of the caste hierarchy and scheming of Kajari, Pratap's wife. Speech plays an important role in bringing these sections in conflict with each other. The small conversations between characters form relationships with images to follow, thus becoming virtual. Babulal's scheming against Mohanlal is heard and seen at the same time. The passerby listening to the conversation between Pratap's family and Kasturi reports it to Babulal. These conversations play an important role in forming the relations between the sets or the shots. The conflict between these sections gets resolved with village conforming to the tradition. Kasturi's story is organized with accelerated montage, as is evident in the last scene, the shots of train approaching the railway crossing, Kasturi's desperate attempt of separating two dueling men, and her running towards the train to stop it are organized with quick cuts. The ambivalent relationship between tradition and modernity in early 20th century India comes forth with this film. I think for now I would stop here and let's see what others have to say about the film. And there are more interesting things to talk about: Bombay Talkies, Devika Rani, Franz Austin, the German director, Josef Pirsching, the camera person, and how these films were perceived in 1930s. Okay, I think I'll stop here for now.
Yeah, thank you very much, Anil, for that very interesting analysis of your film. So it's now open for discussion.
Geeta, if I can...
Yes, please.
Thank you, Anil, for initiating the discussion and also asking us to watch this film. It was very, very interesting and, you know, like a meandering river with so many twists and turns and so unpredictable. So it was a very, very pleasurable film at one level to watch, narratively speaking. I want to just talk about the frame narrative. You two mentioned it. I found that very, very intriguing. If we remove that, so let's say the film begins with the two children playing and then ends with her, with the train, you know, incident and she coming down. So what would have happened and what is the function of the frame narrative? Of course, the film would have ended in a tragedy. So I feel that the frame narrative is performing some very interesting functions. First of all, I feel this couple, I think they remain unnamed, if I'm not wrong. I mean, I'm just basing this on one viewing. So they are an unnamed couple, and there is the gun, and there is this whole mystery that is built up with the ghost, with the reference to some ghost which will come, and the supposed appearance of the ghost as storyteller. That in itself is such an interesting trope, you know, the ghost as the storyteller. So. And then, of course, we are taken to the story. And just before the so-called ghost starts narrating the story, there is also the line which you mentioned where it is said that whoever hears this story, you know, their life will be changed for the better or something like that. So, which almost sounds like your Satyanarayan Katha or whatever, you know. So, what I found very interesting was that you enter the film with this sense of mystery. I mean, the genre seems to be very different. So when you think of Achyut Kanya and, you know, what this film is supposed to be, and then you enter it with this frame narrative, which is doing something quite different. I mean, so which is building up in some ways suspense. And then there is the sharp exchange between the husband and wife, or rather from the husband to the wife, and the presence of the gun and so on. So it's all very mysterious. So the genre, I feel, is a kind of, I mean, it's a misdirection in some ways. I mean, it's taking us in a different direction from what the story would be, would ultimately unfold. So that I found was very interesting. And in the end, so it supposedly fulfills, you know, what the story is supposed to do, which is to transform your life. So the narrative as transforming the life of this couple. So the man decides not to kill the wife. And so it ends happily even for them. But more interestingly and more importantly, I felt that the function of this frame narrative is to redeem what happens to Achyut Kanya. So that it is through the frame narrative we get to see how she is canonized, turned into a goddess. Otherwise, it would have been a tragic end for her. So it's almost as if this is the only way in which you know she can be made to live on, so to speak. And the powerless Achyut Kanya is supposed to be now powerful enough to intervene and transform the lives of people. So in that sense, I thought the function of the frame narrative was quite complex, quite interesting. Yeah, so that is one point. The second point that again struck me about the film is, I mean, Devika Rani's charm, her, you know, acting throughout the film. I mean, she holds the center of the film. So even if the others are kind of bit performers, it's fine because we're kind of transfixed onto Devika Rani and her charm as Achyut Kanya. But again, the question of, I mean, Achyutness, untouchability is often a function of speech. I mean, it is said, emphasized again and again, but not so much, you know, everyone seems to live more or less in the proximity of each other. There is no division of space, you know, and so proscriptions are verbal rather than in practice. At least it doesn't, it's told rather than shown, I feel. So these are my two comments about the film. Thank you again very much, Anil, for the presentation.
Yeah, thank you, Nikhila. Anyone else would like to take it forward from there?
Hi, Gita.
Yes, Vijay, please go ahead.
Good evening, Anil. The presentation was short and precise. That's what I thought. And when I got the information about today's discussion on this movie, one of the oldest movies that we have, I was quickly reminded of some of the reviews that I read in Jaya Karnataka. That was a Kannada journal coming from North Karnataka. And unfortunately, I didn't read the reviews, the small reviews of the movie with the poster and with the publicity of the movie. I even don't know where it was shown in North Karnataka, so I don't remember. But I'm curious to know how this movie was received in Maharashtra or elsewhere. For instance, did you come across anybody making a strong criticism of the movie because it touches upon the issue of untouchability, etc.? Or were there other reviewers or readers who appreciated it for the bold statement or the treatment of the issue, etc.? And how that film was received by the readers and the reviewers? Can you throw some light on the reception of the movie during that time?
Sure, Vijay. And it's interesting to know that you came across its reviews or some sort of advertisement. If possible, try and translate it. That would be interesting to see how it was received. Obviously, it was made in Bombay and mostly screened in and around Bombay, all over Maharashtra, in fact, all over India. But majority of theaters were situated in Maharashtra, in Mumbai. Very positive reviews. Whatever that I came across in the film magazines and journals that were there in 1930s and I had access to in National Film Archives of India, none of the reviews go against the film and the kind of representation that one sees of the social issues. In fact, it was lauded for dealing with a social issue like untouchability. I do have some advertisements of this film. I hope that I get to show you to them. But Devika Rani, as Nikhila ma'am said, was revered like anything. People would write letters to her or to the editors of these magazines asking about her life and what she's doing and what next film she would be in. I think, Vijay, you'll have to wait for some time till I find some of these advertisements of Achyut Kanya and some of the short reviews of the film. In fact, you can go to the Jadavpur University Media Lab, and they do have some of these advertisements. They've made them available online. You can see these advertisements there as well. In fact, Pandit Nehru did watch the film and praised it a lot. This is something that is documented well. And coming back to the frame structure that is being used, thought about it, but I was not sure, because if you have a look at the way the dialogues are delivered by the characters, it's very slow in pace. And the major reason for this, I think most of these early films, sound films, you would come across characters speaking very slowly, is because of this new entry of sound in filming. Earlier, it was silent film that they had to perform for. But the moment sound comes in, the audience now has to witness these two inputs, one the auditory and the other the visual. Obviously, they were used to the visual inputs, but to combine both these inputs, auditory and visual at the same time, I think some of these filmmakers earlier and technicians were not very sure whether the audience would be able to make sense of both the inputs at the same time. But they gradually realized that it's possible. So post 1940s, you have films where the pace of the dialogue is quite normal, 24 frames per second. This too is 24 frames per second, but the characters or the actors, I think, were deliberately asked to be slow as far as dialogues or speaking is concerned. Yes, so again, in the same way, would the audience understand the importance of Achyut Khanna and her sacrifice? Probably that is one of the reasons that there has to be somebody telling that it's because she sacrificed her life, and it's such a good deed that talking about it or listening about it helps you. That's one of the reasons that the frames structure would have been used. And also, would Achyut Khanna be able to tell her own story? Or who is it that is telling Achyut Khanna's story? It has to be someone else. It has to be an external agency. So instead of just a camera, the agency has been given to an old man, a ghost, a mysterious thing which would tell this story of Achyut Khanna. And we still are grappling with this issue of how issues of caste are represented in films, and who is it and who would represent the caste issues. So this film in that way becomes very important.
Okay. Anyone else has anything to say? Yeah, Anil, just taking forward what Nikhila had said, this whole trope of the canonization of Kasturi. She's rendered like an almost saint-like figure with her death. So, I was wondering whether we could is that kind of a depiction of an untouchable girl, is it drawing on a lineage of Dalit saints in India? Like, for instance, there is Choka Mela in Maharashtra. So, on the one hand, he was considered untouchable, but at the same time, he's revered as a poet and a saint. So, there is that kind of very uneasy relationship that is established, on the one hand untouchable, on the other hand revered. So that kind of a lineage also, which perhaps is being drawn on in the depiction of Kasturi. And this film actually came up even last week during our workshop for research scholars, when a research scholar, Chandrakant Kamble from Pune University, presented a paper on narratives of caste in Hindi cinema. And the respondent for that paper, Dr. Santosh Dash, had said that this, you know, the narrative of caste in this particular film should also be seen in the context of the Gandhi-Ambedkar discourses on caste, because the timing is very similar.
Yes.
So, yeah. So, would you like to say something about this?
Yes, exactly, because it this film was released 1936, and it's in 1938 that Dr. Ambedkar, for the first time, uses the word Dalit. And people were not very happy with the word Hari or Harijan that was used by Mahatma Gandhi. So as your comment talked about the earlier part of your comment, that she is revered as some, so though she is an untouchable, but she has to be revered. These were some of the early attempts of dealing with the issue of caste. And most of these people thought about changing the names or some sort of nomenclature to be used, thinking that that might change the perception of the caste or the kind of things that come along with the caste. And as Ambedkar does it in 1938, he says, no, we can't do it that way. We'll have to go in a completely different direction. Yeah, that's why the kind of politics, the politics that comes up after 1930s with the help of Ambedkar's formalization of how to go about it is different from how Gandhi, for example, Mahatma Gandhi would talk about caste or untouchability. So it's again going back to the moment you start revering an Achut Kanya, it's defeating the purpose. Yeah, it's circular, and that's why I say that this is kind of habitual recognition of memory of the story of Achut Kanya, and Nikhila ma'am aptly used the word, it's kind of telling the story of Satyanarayan. It's to remind women of what is being a woman and what you're supposed to do. That's what the Satyanarayan Katha does. And that's what happens in case of Kasturi and her sacrifice and revering her. But you later on, people would say, no, I'm not going to sacrifice. Right? So yes, that way revering is problematic. Though would sound good.
Yeah, it's like a narrative of piety, you know, rather than a discourse of rights. Yeah, anyone else would like to come in?
Can I come in, Geeta?
Please, go ahead.
Anil, thanks for the film. And thanks for the very, very good way to talk about it, you know, to introduce it to someone who has not really thought about it earlier. I am sort of tempted to talk about a few things without not being 100% sure whether I am correct or not, you know. But the thing is that we've been talking about this whole issue of modernity vis-a-vis the film Achut Kanya. The year was 1936. One of the reasons, you know, is that the whole anti-caste narrative is concomitant with the the nationalist movement, you know, because the nationalist movement automatically incorporated certain faults of the Indian society, only by removing which would we become a great free nation. That was one thing. So which they go together side by side. And very strangely, if you watch the film very, very carefully, the sheer presence of Devika Rani is a modernizing factor, you know. Although you may say that it is a kind of colonial modernity, but the fact is that it is a kind of, it may be problematic, but one cannot wish away the fact that it is there. The moment that she comes as a grown woman and calls out to Ashok Kumar as Pratap, you know, with the way she says it, it is indicative of an, you know, city-bred, English-educated woman. And that was the problem, and that was the lure of Devika Rani. That someone who looks like this is also very much... No, that's why this whole issue of cinema being a modernizing factor in those times in our lives, you know. There has been a critique of this kind of colonial modernity wherein the person who has, of course, an excellent pedigree, but the fact is that in a Hindi film, she can't even talk Hindi properly. You know, there is a problem with that, and which was, there's this excellent book by Nipa Mazumdar, you know, when she talks about the heroines in early cinema, and including those action heroines like Hunter Wali and all that, you know, and she talks about another film a few years later, Prabhas Studios, Manus and Aadmi, which, you know, were shot together, which were built together. So there is the, you know, I think it is the two protagonists, the woman and the man. I think the man was V. Shantaram, and Shanta Hublikar was probably the lady. And they run away, and they're going towards the man's village. And by the side of the river, they see a shooting happening. And the shooting happens in a particular way, which is very clearly a parody, because the heroine cannot speak Hindi for her life, you know. And then she, after some time, she gets bored, and she sort of takes off her costume, and she's revealed as having short hair and, you know, wearing a dress and all that, obviously sort of pointing to the fact that most of these early heroines of Hindi cinema, they were either Baghdadi Jews or Jews from Calcutta or from the Anglo-Indian community, you know. So, and they, of course, changed their names. So it is a kind of a critique of that, you know, and also it is interesting in a cinematic way that when the two of them sitting by the side of a river, they parody the way Hindi was being spoken in that film shoot which they have just witnessed, you know. They're doing something more than evoking laughter. It is the first instance is when cinema is taking a look at itself, you know. It is one of the first self-reflexive moments in Indian cinema. And therefore, we realize that what has been one of the problems. There has been one of the problems that by virtue of their connections, by virtue of the fact that she was the wife of Himanshu Roy and all that, and she was talented, she studied theater in London and acted in Germany or wherever, she had to be, but whether you could do away with people, with actors like Devika Rani, you know? So this whole modernity issue, which revolves around the physical and the, you know, the presence of this thing is a problematic factor. But then that's the way it was then. So was cinema itself. With cinema came all the equipment of cinema, because I remember way back in the 80s that there was this, I was told of a very venerable old man called, I forget his name, he would talk about that silent cinema was never silent, you know, in the sense that there would be this orchestra in the pit and there would be this Moonfali Wala in the auditorium walking around, selling his wares, people talking, and suddenly there would be one irritated, angry man who would get up and look towards the projectionist at the back and he would say, "Ki focus kya tera baap theek karega," because the focus was not right. So all this was a part of the ordinary man's vocabulary, and which I would be tempted to say is a point, is a modernizing point, you know. So cinema has to be seen in its totality. That is why characters like Devika Rani are so very important. So, but it is it is self-reflexive. It is even at that early stage, barely 3 years after this film has been made, it is realizing that there are certain faults which we are forced to make virtue of. You know, that is the problem of cinema. Thank you.
Thank you, Anil, would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, it was 19, Banki Chidiya is the song of which the spoof was made. And yeah, that, and also it is surprising how in these films, Britishers somehow are not portrayed as the villains. Even in Achhut Kanya, it's not an outsider. It's the people from the village, elements of the society, which are portrayed as villains. And I don't know, this is something that is interesting because the nationalism in the entire idea of having your own nation was so strong at that point of time. At the same time, one can observe that there is no single establishment shot of the village. That entire village as one single community is not shown at all. It's only you are into the first few scenes of the film, and there's a song sequence where women are singing songs and doing their daily chores, grinding spices, I think. There are shots in which the alleys, various alleys of the village are shown. Otherwise, there is no single American kind of Hollywood type of establishment shot which would show the entire village. Which again, I won't say that it was not possible for them, because the next year, the film that they make, Janmabhoomi, has long shots in it where huge crowds of people are shown together. So it was possible for them, and the camera is kept somewhere up. So it was possible for them to do that establishment shot, but they don't do it. They don't use it.
Okay. Anyone else? Sarkeshwar, Pushi. Yeah, Nikita.
Sorry. Just to come in to read out a comment on Facebook. Ashish Ranjan says, and this film has the distinction of having the first female music composer in India named
Saraswati Devi.
Yeah. So I just wanted to read out that. Also, in response, I think to what Jayanto was saying about Devika Rani playing the Achhut Kanya, I was thinking of the other instance, you know, where P.K. Rosie in the Malayalam context plays, someone from the Dalit community plays the Nair girl, a higher caste person, and how the film simply, you know, the career of the film is destroyed. The theater is nearly burned down, and the film itself kind of disappears from history, you know, till recently efforts have been made to retrieve the film. So modernity or modernization through cinema in a particular kind of direction, someone like Devikarani playing the role of an Achyut Kanya is perfectly fine. Whereas a Dalit woman's entry into the modern space of cinema playing the role of a Nair woman is seen as, you know, threatening to entrench caste interests. Yeah, I'll just stop here.
Would you like to respond, Anis?
No, what she has just stated, what she wanted to say, that's true. And there are no records of Dalit women being present in the film industry, or at least in Bombay. I could not find any. There might be. I'm quite sure that there must be helpers and workers working on the sets, doing lights and helping out. But there are no records. Nothing to be found. So I think one has to explore in this area.
Any other interventions?
Yes, sir, I agree to your point that we do not have any top star coming from Dalit community. Even when we see like top 10 actors, male and female, so we get to see that the Brahmins are coming from upper castes. So, sir, what is the reason? Like, what is your take on it? Like, Dalits, they do not get opportunities like we have now. New generations, they are able to study, they are able to go to foreign countries like Suraj Engre and Yashika Dutt, among others. So like, is it that the industry is so much casteist even today?
I don't think there is any specific answer to it, but yes, what you are pointing at is true. It is, it has to be casteist. That's why we don't have stars as such, but we do have good actors.
Yeah, and directors are also coming.
Directors are also coming too.
Yeah.
Ani, can you see any parallels of it? Because in the same year, Ambedkar has was supposed to deliver a lecture in the caste Hindu forum, Jatpat Todak Mandal, and it was not delivered, and he published that as an independent book, The Annihilation of Caste, the magnum opus. So can you see any parallels between this movie 1936 releasing in a reformist mode agenda and the Ambedkar's movement? See, both are not on the same line. I would like to listen to you.
As Nikhila ma'am has already pointed it out, and Geeta also, that it's kind of revering, and I don't think Ambedkar would have revered any kind of sacrifice by any person, more so by women. So it's not going on those lines. But yes, it's one of the first attempts. At least this is what we could preserve, India could preserve. There was also one more film which dealt with caste issues, but it's not available to be viewed because it did not survive.
Are you referring to Sujata, Bimal Roy Sujata?
No. This is before 1936.
Okay.
Anil, I meant it is a counter, as a counter dialogue to Ambedkar. Are they doing something?
No. I don't think it's kind of counter discourse to Ambedkar's movement. It's just misplaced, misspelled idea of being Achyut and how to present the story which deals with caste. It was way ahead of its time, though. Nobody else would deal with this issue. We have to give the credit to the production house, which decided that we should deal with this issue. And not just because it dealt with this issue, but also because the way the production house operated at that point of time, Bombay Talkies was considered to be one of the best production houses, along with New Theatres in Calcutta and Prabhat in Maharashtra. And all these three production houses dealt with social issues. So K.A. Abbas, as Gita told me a few days back, that we have one talk on K.A. Abbas as well. K.A. Abbas and Babu Rao Patel, these two editors of film journals, would give credit to these three production houses for making films that deal with social issues. So religion would be one of them. Women's issues would be the other. Manus, for example, deals with prostitution, made by Prabhat.
There's a comment in the chat box from Kuti. She says, we just get to see Gandhian vision totally. Dalit assertion is very much missing.
Yes, that's the point. That's what was happening. Dalit assertion would come post 1930s. If not in films, in other art forms.
Tarkeshwar has unmuted. Tarkeshwar, go ahead, please.
Just to, I don't know whether I can conclusively say certain things, but I doubt whether even this narrative presents a Gandhian way of how to handle caste at that point of time. Because there's no change of art to except in one character, that too because he was done a kind of personal favor of by this fellow of taking out the poison. So I don't know whether there is a transformation within the upper caste about this issue. So it's more like a kind of personal bond between the two, and the caste coming in the way of personal bond. So it's more in the sense of a kind of discourse of modernity, individuals and their relationship, whether caste should come in that way or not. So I don't know whether it gets transformed as a kind of social issue. Even if you look at it as a kind of caste issue, what does the narrative represent as caste? Yes, untouchability, but I don't see untouchability anywhere, except in the question of marriage. But the sagotra and marriage is common not only across caste, even within the caste. So in that sense, whom one should marry, this endogamous practices has nothing to do with caste, but it is also one of the aspects of caste. And then the segregation of space as Nikhila was pointing out, that is not seen completely. You see everybody mingling with everyone. In the fair, no problem. And even in other places, we don't see that kind of segregation. They all meet. They all beat up that fellow. They touch that fellow. So there's no question of untouchability anywhere else. He can come to the main market street. He can buy things and they can go back. Whether in the fair or in the market street. So there's nowhere where you can clearly say, here there's a kind of untouchability practice. Except in the discourse of marriage. Yes, it is used by, as in a kind of, in the words, in the dialogues, it comes out. But mainly by this doctor. But that is again a kind of, the narrative shows that he has a personal motive to rake it up. So it's actually not there as a social problem, but a personal problem gets articulated as a kind of caste problem in the village. So in that sense, it is not represented as a kind of social problem. It is also because this family, the so-called untouchable family, is a government servant. And he has a pakka house, a quarters, a guard's house, compared to the Brahmin's house, which is a kind of hut. So in that sense, he has a better housing facility compared to other Brahmins in the village. And the Brahmins are not even, one is a kind of doctor, a village doctor, the other is a kind of merchant that we have seen. So nowhere they're represented as a priestly caste who can control the other villagers. So one fellow is trying to control the other villagers through a modern medicine. The old one is trying to control the other villagers through the traditional medicine, claiming that it is handed over. So there is nowhere the control of the Brahmin community over the others is established there. So they have to rely on something else to rally people around them. So in that sense, it's quite interesting, a Brahmin coming as a member of a merchant community. And interestingly, one fellow is a Shaivite Brahmin. If you go through the symbols that come, the other fellow is a Vaishnavite. I don't know what it has to do with the entire thing. So, and then the framing, as Nikhila said, is completely different. A kind of mystery. It looks like a kind of just arousing your curiosity about in the middle of the night, what is happening there? Somebody is going to come and narrate the story. What is the story? Who is she? And then at the end, a domestic problem, which was supposed to end in a murder, gets resolved by listening to the story. And she is capable of resolving these domestic problems. So she becomes a kind of a deity who could resolve these problems. So in that sense, and all through the narrative, you see only the how a woman should sacrifice herself for the husband. And apart from Devikirani, you also have another Dalit woman there, Kajri. And her family is looks like an upper class compared to anyone else in the entire film. They want to keep the son-in-law at home and give him property, and the kind of jewelry that she has on her body is also quite amazing. So nowhere, the way the caste is represented is only in the dialogues, only in terms of endogamous marriage, where across caste, the marriage is not permitted. But otherwise, in terms of spatial segregation, even in terms of touchability, even in terms of economic distinctions, we don't see much as caste. So what is it representing as caste? And only looks like a discourse of modernity where individuals should have the freedom to mingle with each other and even to the extent of marrying. So caste should not come in that way. That only seems to be the kind of discourse about caste that comes through this film. If at all, if caste is coming in the way of friendship and marriage. Otherwise, the other connotations of caste that we are familiar with it today are other movements have articulated. I don't see that in this. And apart from this, caste is not seen as a problem at all, because there are different communities in the village and each one marries within their own community. In that sense, untouchability is also not a endogamy should not be a problem there in those communities too. So in that sense, there's no articulation of caste itself as a problem. So I don't know whether I'm making sense here.
Yes, yes, perfectly. Very interesting observation. But the only thing is that the caste as an issue is being used, as you rightly pointed out, one, wherever these characters have to or get an opportunity to practice their own choices, which is one of the pointers of modernity, choosing their partner, they fail, and it's based on caste. And also caste is being used by Babulal Baid, the medicine man, uses it as an excuse to avenge Mohanlal. So which also shows, though it is not being very clearly shown, how people from different castes would mingle together or be there in the village with their own sets of rules. One of the rules that is being broken is Mohanlal entertaining the railway guard in his house, which is being used against him, and his house is broken and burned by the crowd attacking him. And yes, the other aspects of caste are not touched upon at all.
Even Pratap and Kasturi, for that matter, they sit with each other during that Pulakshata ride. So there is the kind of, and even amongst the other villagers, there is a kind of fraternization that goes beyond caste. So as Sarkeshwar said, that the articulation of caste is restricted to the matter of marriage,
personal choice. Also, there are frames where Kasturi and Pratap are shown sitting together on the same plane, whereas there would be frames where Mohanlal and Dukhiya, when they are sitting together, chatting with each other, they are not sitting on the same plane. Mohanlal would always be shown sitting on the higher plane. And I'm quite sure that some thought has gone into this kind of framing.
Any more interventions? Any more questions? Sridhar says, how to see the social boycott faced by Brahmin family? Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was saying, though we can say that other issues of caste are not touched upon in the film. What happens to the Brahmin family, as we see in the film, that the entire house is burned and destroyed by the crowd. It happens because of some of the rules that are being broken.
Yeah, Yeah, Nikhila.
No, I was just pointing out that again, this seems to be quite a familiar concept or theme. Like in Prabhat films, Eknath, for instance, the social boycott that you know, the Brahmin family faces for commingling with other castes, with the lower castes and so-called untouchables, and so on. So this it's a film that is drawing on some of the familiar themes and tropes of the times. So rather than being in some ways a you know, a social film on a social theme, it's I think drawing the elements of mystery from some film, the presence of ghost, and then this, which is again a very familiar, I think, many films in Marathi will have this kind of, if I'm not wrong, this kind of ostracism that, you know, the Brahmin family faces, the trials and tribulations that they undergo because they mix with. So that way, again, I think it's fairly common to many other films of the time.
Yes, 1930s, early talkies, all these films were trendsetters. Even the kind of tropes that we see today in Bollywood films, you would see that some of the ways in which the type characters are treated in 1930s, the same trend follows. And also, what continues even today is the way it comes only twice in the film. The way the touch is being treated, the moment Dukhiya touches Mohanlal to suck out his venom, the touch is acceptable, neutralized. This is something that society would not mind. Whereas, due to the stricter rules in the village, the moment Mohanlal takes Dukhiya to his house to take care of him in his illness, that is something that is not allowed. That kind of touch or that kind of sociability is not at all entertained and is used against the Brahmin family.
So this taking somebody into your house who belongs to a different community need not be untouchability. It has nothing to do with untouchability per se. So it could be any other community too. It could have been articulated. It could have been used against that particular family. And then whether there was an ostracization or boycotting of that family, find out. Yes, there is an attack on that family, a mob attack instigated by a particular person. And he has a particular motive, which has nothing to do with caste. That is very clear in the narrative. And as soon as the act of attack is completed, you also have people advising them, don't worry, we will build the house again. No problem.
But the grocery shop that they run at village has to be shifted to the what is it called? The weekly mart. No takers are there in the village. No one is buying with them. That is what the narration he gives.
Yeah, the narration says he is not able to sell it in the village because the shop doesn't exist now. So I don't know
one is willing, he says. No one is buying with us.
So I might have to watch that bit again.
See, everything won't be said. It's a sheer game of defacing whatever the assertive element that is building up in Maharashtra at that point of time. Pune Pact has taken place. Before that also, there were many incidents. It's not, you cannot think that it is done in a very art form way or anything nothing to do with the world of things going on around. That's all our blindness only. But I could see a parallel case that argues against the kind of liberation theology that Ambedkar is arguing for. It's completely an antithesis to Ambedkar. That much I could see.
No, one could say that, but I don't know whether it, as Anil was saying, whether it has actually a response to Ambedkar.
You will believe only when they use Ambedkar's name.
No, it need not be. But yeah, it can be read like that. I have no problem with reading that into the narrative. But I was trying to understand what it is actually doing with the question of untouchability. So it is not actually articulating the question of relations between the communities, but it is articulating the question of individual choices in terms of marriage and friendship. I think that's what I could see in that. And it also attacks the colonial administration. So there is a problem in the village, and they come and sack this fellow from his railway guard job. That is quite astonishing, because he is the one who has caused all the problem, sack him from the job. So, but again, interestingly, the replacement is also from the same community. And the Dalit who come in this narrative, one is a railway guard, the other is a well-to-do family. So in that sense, what is it coming out as caste in this? So, and then again, it is not caste, it's untouchability. It's taking the name of untouchability. There is no mention of any caste community except the Brahmin. So in that sense, the caste question getting translated as untouchability and untouchability getting translated as the problem of exercising individual choices in terms of friendship and marriage seems to be the way the narrative unfolds. And the way the narrative is, and the issue is framed, is another matter altogether. It becomes a kind of question of domesticity and gender, which come to the fore in terms of the framing of the entire narrative.
One more thing one could see is that, see, when Brahmin character, the reformist character speaks, he speaks in a general tone. Whereas when it comes to this guard, or the railway guard, or his daughter, the lead role of the movie, they internalize the discrimination. They accept it. It is not practiced. So we also don't practice. We'll obey it. So they resign from whatever they wish to. Actually, she's in love with the boy, but when it comes to the marriage, when there is an opposition seen in the village, not in the family, she resigns. Why should we create problem? So
yeah, it is with regard to marriage.
Let me complete, man. See, here here only Dalit characters are internalizing the dissent and submitting to it. So what could I read is that it is the beneficial nature of the Hindu society that is allowing you to survive. So you should survive at their mercy. So if you breach that, you will face the consequences. That could only I see in the entire drama of the spicy language, whatever they used, whatever they picturized, I could see even in 1930s, it's such a derogatory ideology. I don't know. I cannot see anything positive in it.
No, I was just saying
that social is anti-Dalit and Brahmin social.
Yes, Tarkeshwar, go ahead, please.
No, I just wanted to say that this internalization is only with regard to marriage. She resigns with, yes, I can't marry you, but they can be friends. They can talk to each other. They can meet each other. They can travel together. There's no problem with that. That's how the narrative unfolds. So I don't know where this, what is seen as caste in the entire narrative is something that intrigues me.
But if you enter their house, the host's house will be burnt.
No, entering is also fine. They've entered several times. But
no,
only
no.
When it...
No. You don't have any scene that girl entering into the house or that man entering into the house before that. Only for treatment sake, he brings him. Because
and they can't eat together.
No, even this other Brahmin also has no problem in treating the Dalits.
But there are no scenes. You are imagining things.
No, I'm not imagining. See, let me complete, Sridhar. Even the Pratap's wife meets the other Dalit girl in her house. So they discuss about her marriage. So she can also enter their house and have discussion about it. So in that sense, there is social interaction between women of different communities. And they all go together to the fair, village fair. And they all mingle together. There's no restrictions anywhere there. So whether the fair allows some kind of anonymity to them, I don't know. Or these two come as individual families. They don't come as representatives of a community, except in the dialogue. But visually, either this railway guard or that Kajri's family, they come as individual families, not as representative of a particular community. And both these families are well-to-do in terms of economics. That is quite intriguing to me.
Okay, thank you, Tarkeshwar. Anil, any response to what Tarkeshwar?
These are interesting observations by Tarkeshwar, sir. So I think we all will have to have a look at the film again and think about these issues. In what way caste is represented or presented in the film? What are the elements that we can say would justify the title Achhut? Achhut Kanya, whether it remains only at the level of an individual and the points where the characters have to practice their individual choices, or whether it comes again to the social structure as such. So, yeah.
Yeah,
Nikhila,
you want to say something?
I think Tarkeshwar made this point, but just to push it a little further, the film is making out a case for companionate marriage. What might have been a perfectly happy companionate marriage if it was not for caste? And the kind of distorted, kinds of marriages that both these people find themselves in, Kasturi as well as Pratap.
Kajri.
Yeah, okay. So the kind of distortions in relationships, if you hold on to caste, and what might have been if it were not for caste, or if it was not for barrier of some kind. So if in this film it is caste, in some other film it might be religion or something else. So it's more in the kind of barrier to companionate marriage I think Jayanto was absolutely right when you know he said that this is a film that is more like a discourse on modernity, individualism, companionate marriage, and the place of caste or the crudities you know that it engenders in this process. Yeah, I'll just stop.
Any other responses?
I would like to say one of the things about the canonization that you talked about. I think that's a really problematic issue because they don't let people live, right? And then you canonize them. And this is not only in the film, but you have that in historical events. Like you have this Sidra Jay Singh of Patan, who asked this Dalit guy to, he's looking for a person with eight, what's it called? Gifts or eight super gifts or something of the sort. And that guy has to be sacrificed, right? And that's supposed to be historical. And they have the temple of Maya, who's a Dalit, right? And you have Ranki Bhav just opposite each other in Patan, right? So I think, Aniket and I were talking about it once, and we wondered, how do you find all these people only in the Dalit community? How do you get sacrifice only from there, right? I think that's a question which we have to talk about and think about, because the only good Dalit is a dead Dalit. That's what it looks like when we look at this kind of memorializing, etc. Of course, this is a rather negative kind of take on the film, but I think that's a different kind of viewpoint.
Would you like to respond, Ani?
Yes, Rajan, that's what we were saying, that's what we were talking about, right? Someone like Ambedkar would not agree with this kind of representation at all. Exactly for the reason that a Dalit being revered for sacrificing herself is a problematic position.
I think this question of sacrifice also needs some more interrogation. Did anyone sacrifice her? Because there are many women deities in India. If you look at their stories, somebody sacrifices them for a larger cause, for building a dam, building a tank, issues like that. Or some injustice has been meted out to them and they die. As a kind of retribution, you construct a temple for them. So these two are, as Rajan was saying, a common trope in many of the in the case of many village women deities that we find in India, unless they are Sanskritized to become Lakshmi, Kali, or Parvati, or something like that. Otherwise, these are the stories. Either somebody sacrifices them, or some injustice has been meted out to them, and in order to cover up, or as a kind of to satisfy yourself, you start worshipping them. This is a kind of common trope. But here, was there a sacrifice? Her husband and her friend, they're fighting it out. As you said, it's a duel between the two. And it is interesting. And it's a Dalit man who is attacking him. So he starts attacking him because he thinks that fellow has taken away his wife. So that is the kind of thing. So it's completely kind of a patriarchal value that comes up there. And they are fighting with each other. And this girl and others are unable to separate them out. And the train is approaching. And it's a kind of a kind of you don't know how to end the narrative. The best ways to end the narrative is to kill this character. Because this is a kind of a triangular love story. If you look at in our films, in a triangular love story, somebody has to die. That's how. That's the only way you can resolve the narrative. Otherwise, you don't know how to handle it. So it looks like more like a kind of way to resolve the narrative. And the framing, she becomes a kind of a DTR, an angel who will solve your marital problems, something like that. So I don't know whether it's a kind of sacrifice, a kind of suicide from our side, or somebody else sacrificing her for a larger good, or it's the narrative sacrifices her to resolve itself.
Yes, these are some of the questions that we should think about.
Okay. Anything else? Anyone else?
Tara, even Rajan's question was that why all village deities are Dalits?
See,
so what are you searching for? I didn't know. You want the either of the man should throw her onto the railway platform or the railway track or what?
No, I am not sure whether all the village deities are Dalit, because Dalit is a modern category for me, which comes up in the
untouchables, almost all.
No, I have also found even other women, including from the dominant communities. Maybe if we can find even upper caste women could be found. But anyway, there is an injustice that has been meted out to them. Are they sacrificed? Are forced to sacrifice themselves? We don't know. Yeah, Rajan has a point. That is well taken.
Any more questions, comments? Okay, then we'll bring this session to an end. Thank you very much, Anil, for this very interesting session on Achhut Kanya. And thank you all for logging in and taking part in this discussion. Good night.
Thank you, Anil, for the discussion.
Thank you, Anil, for introducing that movie.
So it was worth discussing the earlier movie.
Thank you.
I would like to thank all the participants, particularly Tharkeshwar, sir, Sridhar, sir, Nikhila, ma'am, Gita, and Rajan. And of course, Jayanto.
Thank you. Thank you, Anil. Good night, everyone. Thank you.
Good night.
Bye. Good night.
Good night.